So, good afternoon, welcome to you all, and thank you for coming. I am Suleiman Bachir Diagne. I'm the chair of the French department, and it is my pleasure to welcome you all here on behalf of the French department and of Maison Française, and Shani Pierre, my colleague and friend Shani Pierre, who is the director of Maison Française. This is quite an event. We have the pleasure of having Gary Ryder with us and to have this wonderful panel with Gayatri and Etienne Balibar, Gayatri Spivak and Etienne Balibar, who are going to have a conversation around this book with Gary Ryder. And we thank the Maison Française for organizing this. We thank the ICRS, the Institute for Comparative Research and Society, and the Institute of African Studies. These are the co-sponsors who made possible this event. I need to say that this event was first thought of and organized by my colleague and friend Emmanuel Sada, professor in the French department. She could not be here today, and so it is my pleasure to be the chair and the moderator of this panel on Freedom Time. The book of Gary, the subtitle is Negritude, Decolonization, and the Future of the World. Let me just say
this.
Yes, exactly, no less. Let me just say that negritude is back. Negritude is really back if I judge by the publications I have seen these past years. And Gary's work, not just this book, but the previous one, is a great part of the fact that negritude is back. We have lived for so long with this assumption that we knew everything about negritude once we have said that this is a counter-essentialism against colonial essentialism. And this was just oversimplification. And probably now, with the time passing, it has come this period where we read negritude, and this is what these authors were just asking for, and Gary did that wonderfully. Just a couple of hours ago, I was doing my seminar on negritude, and with my students, we read a text in which Senghor was basically saying that the whole problem with the crisis that we are witnessing in our world is that there was a fundamental crisis, which is the crisis of civilization. And what he called the crisis of civilization is the fact that all cultures are not coming together to make up what he called the following Théâtre de Chardin, French philosopher Théâtre de Chardin, a civilization of the universe, a moment when all cultures are going to converge and produce the civilization of the universal, as he called it. And he's saying, well, the solution was already here, because we had actually in 1889 the revolution that would allow us to put together the elements of that civilization of the universal, and that revolution was, for him, what philosophers like Bergson, artists like Picasso, or Arthur Rimbaud, or Paul Claudel had produced around the early 20th century. I'm mentioning this because we have to think of the authors of negritude as global thinkers. The reason why we considered that negritude was just this counter-essentialism against colonial essentialism is that we were too much entrapped with the notion that the colonizer has as his or her only interlocutor, the colonized has as his or her only interlocutor, the colonizer, and that these people were basically addressing colonial France. We forget something. They thought of themselves, and they indeed were global thinkers. They were thinking the totality, the future of the world, as Gary just said. So independence, colonialism, was part of their thinking. It was not all of their thinking. and this is at the center of the work that Gary has produced, not only in this book, but in the previous book. And this is something that is very important. He has really put, again, Negritude on the map, and we have made it very actual and worthy of our thought, and we have to thank him for that. So I will give the floor to Gary for 20 minutes, and he will present his book and his work, not more. No. And after that, I will give the floor to my friends, Etienne Balibar, my friends and colleagues, Etienne Balibar and Gayatri Spivak. Let me just say a word about Gary. Gary is professor of anthropology at the graduate school, CUNY graduate school. That's all I need to say.
That's all you need to say.
Yes.
I'm laughing about presenting the book because you know how when your memories start to be memories of the photographs as opposed to the events, as I talk about the book in different places, I'm starting to forget the book, and my memory of the book is based on these short introductions. Okay. So let me continue with the thank yous. Thank you, Bachir, for doing this. Thank you, Etienne. It is really a privilege and a gift to be in dialogue with the three of you about this book, and mostly, rather than the book, the issues that that Senghor and Césaire invite us to think about. That's really the point of all this, and it's very important. I also want to thank Shani Pierre and Emmanuel Sada for organizing this and having this idea. And the Maison Française. I've presented versions of this here at different moments and have been in a series of really useful and stimulating conversations about these kinds of issues in this room over the last 5 years many times. And it really seems to be an exciting moment in French studies and an exciting place for French studies. So it's perfect to be here. Okay, so Emmanuel asked me to start with an introduction to the book. I'll just say a little bit about, for about 15, 20 minutes, I'll sketch out some of the arguments, but this is by no means a summary. So as I say in the first sentence, the book is about the problem of freedom at the end of empire. It examines how decolonization raised fundamental questions for subject peoples about the frameworks within which self-determination could be meaningfully pursued in relation to a given set of conditions. Self-determination at a certain historical moment. Specifically, I treat 1945 as a world historical opening when the contours of the post-war order that we now know were not yet fixed, and when a range of solutions to the prospect of colonial emancipation were imagined and pursued. But when at the same time, the converging pressures of anti-colonial nationalism, European neocolonialism, American globalism, and UN internationalism also made it seem to be a foregone conclusion that the post-war world would be organized around territorial national states. So both of those pressures are existing at exactly the same moment. So at the center of the story, as Bachir was just telling us, are attempts by Aimé Césaire from Martinique and Léopold Sédar Senghor from Senegal to overcome colonialism without falling into what they regarded as the trap of national autarky. So they proceeded from a belief that late imperialism itself had created conditions for new types of post-national and transcontinental political association. Each, in very different ways that I'll run together here, hoped to fashion a legal framework that would recognize and democratize the history of interdependence that bound metropolitan and overseas peoples to one another. So these were their starting points, and from these starting points, they envisioned non-national forms of decolonization, what I keep calling throughout this book, self-determination without state sovereignty, through which the entire French Empire, colonies and metropole, would be reconstituted as a decentralized, democratic, socialist federation. The aim was both to abolish colonial imperialism, certainly, but also to transcend unitary republicanism. This constitutional struggle to create a framework for what we might call autonomy without autarky was tied, and this is just as important as Bashir was saying, to their deeper desire to redeem an alienated modernity and allow humanity to realize itself more fully. Precisely by allowing specific peoples to realize their distinctive potentialities and through practices of mutuality and reciprocity that might create new forms of differential unity. So the future of the world, in the subtitle, refers to their conviction that decolonization provided colonized peoples with an opportunity and even charged them with the responsibility to remake the world, to institute a new epoch of disalienated human history. So that's not my conceit that I'm explaining the remaking of the world, but that was their conviction. So let me step back a bit. Stepping back a bit from that kernel of argument, I'll try to identify a few major interventions that the book tries to make. Rather than summarizing the argument, this is where I'm trying to intervene. First, as Bashir was suggesting, I'm trying to engage scholarship on negritude by treating Césaire and Senghor as critical intellectuals and global figures of the post-war period. So I'm trying to challenge the scholarly tendency that often treats them one-sidedly as only offering affirmative theories of Africanity or black subjectivity, rather than also working out critical theories of modernity. I'm trying to question the provincialism, the territorialism, the culturalism that I think continues to suffuse so much intellectual history and certain currents of post-colonial theory. So my aim is not to provincialize Europe, important as this operation has and continues to be, but to deprovincialize African and Caribbean thought, and to do so in ways that raise questions about the very categories Europe or France. So contrary to popular belief, I argue, Césaire and Senghor did not simply formulate a critique of Western civilization from the standpoint of Antillean or African culture is important. It's not a civilizational critique. Rather, they developed, in my reading, a critique of modern racism, imperialism, and capitalism from the standpoint of an Antillean and African history, conditions, experiences, and forms of life. Even more fundamentally, as I read them, they offer a critique of modernity itself, which they characterized as alienating and dehumanizing. Which for them was characterized by alienating and dehumanizing forms of abstraction and reification, classification and atomization. So they criticized that aspect of modern life from the standpoint of embodied and poetic ways of being and knowing and relating. Relating to nature, relating to others, relating to the dead, relating to themselves, to oneself. So the key point is that in my reading, they were always looking to identify within traditions, within African traditions, within Antillean traditions, and within European traditions, those residues of and resources for more human, more integrated, and more just forms of collective life. So in other words, I read them as hoping to overcome the modern conditions that have impoverished human life in colonial and metropolitan societies. And they refused the idea that they should approach modern philosophy or aesthetics or politics as foreigners rather than as heirs or rightful owners of collective property. So I think that's really one of the key moves I'm trying to make in rereading these guys I'm not going to repeat myself. So I try to read Césaire and Senghor as situated humanists, concrete cosmopolitans, embodied universalists, who struggled to reconcile self-management and human solidarity. Again, they regarded decolonization not only as a way to secure political liberty or improve material well-being for their constituents, which they certainly did, but as an opportunity to transform the global order, to promote and model a new planetary politics based on mutuality, reciprocity, solidarity, métissage. So that's one intervention into scholarship about these figures and the Negritude Project in general. Second, the account is trying to push against the methodological nationalism that I think has so, and many of us think, has so overdetermined histories of decolonization in the post-war period. So again and again, we presume that decolonization means national liberation, and then debate whether a given individual or event helped or hindered that presumptive outcome, rather than ask about the historically specific process through which one was made to seem the necessary counterpart of the other. So that's what I'm more interested in doing. So to be clear, I'm not arguing against anti-colonial nationalism at all, but only against those for whom self-determination is unthinkable apart from state sovereignty. I'm arguing against those who would presumptively dismiss these figures as imperial apologists simply because they were not revolutionary nationalists. So I'm not claiming that nationalism was wrong and federalism was right. On the contrary, my point here, following their lead, is that there can be no a priori formulas for human freedom, only situated and risky experiments that must be tried and revised depending on what works and in relation to ever-changing historical conditions and political fields. To me, their struggles and reflections underscore that colonial emancipation and self-determination are genuine problems for which there are no ready-made trans-historical solutions. So what I'm trying to do is reflect on decolonization as a process of global restructuring and the post-war period as both a world historical opening where other political possibilities were envisioned and a large-scale process through which such futures were systematically foreclosed by a whole set of converging forces. So what I'm, another way of saying that is I'm trying not to use the categories that were produced by that process to analyze that process. Third, another zone of kind of intervention here. As the title suggests, the book is also fundamentally about the intersection between the problem of freedom and the politics of time, or the problem of time and the politics of freedom. So throughout, I try to discuss how what I call, throughout I discuss how untimely processes and practices and objects pose productive challenges for understanding history and thinking politics, whether we want to think about that moment or our moment. So the term freedom time, the title, refers both to decolonization as a time for freedom and to the peculiar temporal dynamics that were set into motion through and during decolonization. So for example, figures like Senghor and Césaire, and not only them, wrote and acted often as if they belonged to different epochs, whether past or future. They often and typically engaged predecessors as contemporaries and addressed future generations proleptically. They continued to identify vital possibilities that were sedimented within seemingly outmoded projects and existing arrangements, even as they also anticipated worlds that had not yet arrived. They continually undertook poetic acts of political imagination, whereby they acted as if seemingly impossible alternatives were already at hand, right? Acting as if that the impossible future were already at hand, but at the same time, they always identified aspects of existing arrangements whose logics, if fully embraced and thoroughly pursued, might lead to a radically different social order. So I read Césaire and Senghor as utopian realists and realist utopians. They're really asking us to rethink deeply held assumptions about this obvious distinction between realism and utopianism. They were always working to reframe conventional assumptions about what is possible and what is impossible. As I read them, they were always combining very close attention to the best possible prospect in a given situation with practices of utopian anticipation. So they were very canny readers of a given situation, but they also always took the long view, and that long view was back, both backwards and forwards in matters concerning colonial emancipation, social improvement, and human reconciliation. So their reading of history demonstrated that massive gaps, and this is one of the lessons, massive gaps often in time, big temporal distances, often separate an act or utterance from its political effectivity or even legibility, and that when the future of the world is at stake, success and failure can only be reckoned across generations and epochs. So methodologically, following Walter Benjamin, this is part of the temporal intervention. I try through the book, methodologically, to construct a series of historical constellations between apparently distinct epochs. So for example, I trace how Césaire's vision of departmentalization in 1946 was refracted through the spirit of Victor Schœlcher and his unrealized program for the abolition of slavery in 1848, and then how Césaire's vision of federalism was then refracted through the spirit of Toussaint Louverture's 1801 constitution and his unrealized program for self-government within a federal framework. I also examine how Senghor did not only invoke African forms of collective life and practices of sympathetic knowing, which he certainly did, but just as fluently and confidently identified with pre-Socratic Greeks, with the early Christian church, with the writings of Marx and Proudhon. And similarly, I, following their lead, try to construct a historical constellation between the post-war opening, this moment when the problem of freedom was a global question, and our post-Cold War present. That's part of what the book is trying to do. So, here, Freedom Time could be read also as an inquiry into historical temporality, and it's a kind of very imperfect attempt to work out or to try out a non-genealogical version of the history of the present, a different kind of history of the present. And I guess the fourth zone of intervention is that the book tries to offer a set of political theoretical reflections on colonial emancipation, on self-determination, federalism, cosmopolitanism, and post-national democracy. I was going to say more about that, but I think I'm going to stop there, except to say that in some ways it's an attempt to work at the intersection of intellectual history and critical theory. I hesitate to say that because I am certainly not a critical theorist, but the spirit of critical theory, as we constantly talk about the need to, I'm looking at my colleague Susan Buckmore's right here, we just talking about that gap between the is and the ought that has to be part of even the most rigorous and careful historical work. So in that sense, I hope it's rigorous intellectual history, but intellectual history informed by a set of normative concerns, and that is a critical intervention that is seeking to raise questions for how we think about their world and our world by thinking with these figures. I have a few more pages. But we'll open it up, and we'll get to the rest in the conversation. So I'll stop there.
Thank you very much. Now, for a few minutes, Etienne Balibar is going to say a few words about the book. Start a conversation with Gary, ongoing conversation, because Etienne has been a thorough reader of Freedom Time already. I will not introduce Etienne Balibar, except to say that he is one of our very colleagues in the French department. Now he's really based in our French department. He's a great French philosopher. And probably it is fitting not to say anything but just that he's the philosopher of equality. That would be fitting for the theme that we have right now.
Thank you. So which of these
this one
does work? This one?
Yeah.
Okay, gooseneck, you call it. Good. Okay, so you cut me when I have reached the limit, not before but not after. And therefore, I might have to stop in the middle, but this is, again, not a big problem, because I'm sure things which could have been said at the beginning will return in the conversation. So my intention is to, Bachir alluded to the fact that I have been careful, and I'm an enthusiastic reader of the book already some time ago. This is because I had the privilege and honor of being asked to review it, and therefore I will take from this this review a passage, because I wouldn't do better now, in which I tried to summarize what I considered from my point of view, of course, three very crucial dimensions of Gary's book and project. And if there's a little bit of time left, I have three questions that I would like to ask, but we'll see. So, okay, so I think that first, extremely important, and of course I partially repeat something that he has introduced himself, very important aspect of this book, coming after the previous one on the imperial nation, is a paradigm shift in the discussion of social and cultural formations, already well indicated in the title of his first book, from a nation-centered perspective, meaning in particular in the French case, a perspective centered on the external projection of the Republican nation, to a perspective centered on empire, or more precisely on the reciprocal determination of the metropolitan nation and the colony within the long-term structure of the empire. The nation is internally affected by its imperial character as much as the colony is affected, as much as the colony is affected by the transformations in the governance of the nation state, such as its shifting from pure liberalism to welfarism in the interwar period. This develops and carries further previous indications in the history of, I would like to call, critical theory in a broad sense, particularly indications coming from Hannah Arendt, and it leads to, in her famous considerations of the crisis of the nation state in the volume of Origins of Totalitarianism called Imperialism, and it leads to a complete organic reformulation of the dilemmas and hierarchies of citizenship and subjection within French nationalism. One of the reasons, not the only one, why it is to be wished, of course, that this book be translated soon into French, is the extent to which such a view could destabilize entrenched representation of the French national history in modern times, which of course is full of considerations on the importance of the nation and desperately lacking awareness of the importance of empire, except in very conservative forms. The second aspect that I would like to emphasize, more philosophical, Bachir already alluded to that very insistently, and Gary returned to it, but directly deriving from the first, is a transformation in the definition of the categories of the universal and the particular, and the corresponding isms, universalism, particularism, in their historical and dialectical function. Already in his first book, Gary Wilder had insisted on the idea of running against the dominant tendencies of Eurocentric universalism, as well as anti-colonial or post-colonial culturalism, that there is no such thing as a single and simple location of universalism, or conversely, its betrayal, on one side of the imperial divide, and particularism, or its reversal, on the other side. For the two logical contraries, the universal and the particular, are always present on both sides, although, of course, in antithetic manners. This has concrete implications on our understanding of the contradictions of colonial administration, as well as the double bind to which anti-colonial emancipatory discourses are subjected. It explains why it is so important to show that the most incisive struggle against a colonial discourse that thinks of itself as humanism, which we, of course, should not pure and simply confuse with humanitarianism, was not an abstract anti-humanist discourse, but a discourse that subverted and reconstructed humanism from the inside, which is precisely what Senghor and Césaire successfully tried to do. It also derives structurally from the fact that universality is neither the ideal extension of the Republican nation, nor the refutation of its self-referential identity, but rather, I submit after what I understood of Gary's position, the conflictual expression of the dialectics of nation and empire itself. I will return to this if I have a minute for that. Third, the alternative to empire in Senghor's and Césaire's political imagination was what they call the federation, a notion with a long and complex history, of course, that could be elaborated in constitutional terms in contradistinction to the short-lived Union Française projected by de Gaulle after World War II as a French counterpart to the British Commonwealth, but also and more profoundly as a civic and cultural metamorphosis of the empire itself. Leaving apparently intact its envelope, it would establish within its boundaries a pluralism of languages, cultures, and memberships, and a regime of equality based on mutual recognition, therefore leading not to antithetic independences, but to dynamic interdependences. Needless to say, this third aspect, which is directly political, is of primary interest in our age of post-national elaborations. In fact, what Gary Winder is intent on showing is the fact that the current evolutions and the obstacles they meet are better defined as post-imperial than post-national constellations, if one wants to take into account a history that is no longer Eurocentric. But this also shows how important it has become to problematize decolonization in terms of its internal alternatives, bifurcations, or points of heresy. Beside the question who decolonizes whom, there's also the question of choosing between decolonization as inversion or reversal of the colonial relationship of domination, and decolonization as deconstruction of domination itself. This is not an easy choice for sure, but it is increasingly insisted today. And the radical way in which it is presented by Gary is sure to produce new and useful controversies after those already produced by his first book, not only in general strategic terms, but in terms of his readings of specific emblematic figures. And here, of course, I'm thinking this is certainly going to be one of the most controversial points, his critique of Fanon compared to Césaire and or Senghor, which nevertheless never does not erase Fanon's own complexity and, of course, doesn't judge his crucial political commitment. Am I... do I have still a couple of minutes, or is it there? Okay. So, after this kind of broad summary, I would like to return to three points on which I'd very like to hear further elaborations from Gary. The first point concerns what he calls and what can be considered is methodological non-nationalism or anti-nationalism. I mean, He speaks, for example, borrowing from or commenting on Césaire, of a non-national orientation to decolonization. I do believe, and this is sure not to be unanimously agreed, that this could be one of the keys, if not the key, to a non-national orientation to politics, and in fact to cosmopolitics in the current situation. Therefore, not only for the ex-colonies or parts of the world which have been dominated by empires, but in the whole of the post-colonial world, which includes former colonies and semi-colonies and former empires, and perhaps also some intermediary places. But of course, this leads to try and understand better what non-national exactly means. So I take it, and he's repeated that now, that it doesn't mean anti-national. It rather means something like a capacity to deconstruct the internal knot, I would say, historically so strongly established by all our history, between national identity or even national constituency and political institutions and nationalism, particularly in the form of the vindication of sovereignty. And it also does not exactly mean post-national, because the two things are linked. Gary doesn't think, and I agree with him, that nations are bound to disappear in some sort of homogeneous cosmopolitan order or constellation. Now, from this point of view, of course, things are relatively enigmatic. And I believe to understand that Gary's position or proposal, which I find very interesting, is intimately linked with his idea that nation and empires were never totally and independent realities. So this leads us to questioning the what I would call the European prototype of the nation, as it has in fact permeated the whole world as a consequence of decolonization. European nations were inseparably empires or parts of an imperial project which dominated the world for several centuries. And decolonized nations, taking the whole trajectory of decolonization, which begins in fact very early in Latin America, North America in the late 18th century, perhaps even before. Ireland is part of that. And ending or leading, because this is not the end, to the most recent processes of decolonization, clearly remained haunted by the specter of empire. And this is a point on which Fanon was not blind. The nations, the post-colonial nations, immediately had imperial projects, or they were somehow haunted by that possibility or that necessity. So would it be your suggestion that in fact, to borrow Chakrabarty's famous words that you put at a distance a moment ago, Europe would not become really provincialized as long as the European model of the nation will dominate the world, including those who rejected the European domination? My second question, I hope this is not too intricate, that's the point, yes. The second would be a shorter. And the second question has to do with the meaning of what you call federalism. So, of course, you're not suggesting that we should rewrite history or return to the moment in which Senghor, particularly, and also Césaire, used the category federalism to offer from within the post-war political configuration of French imperialism, an alternative to the domination of the metropolis. But you are certainly suggesting that the notion of federalism or federation, with its Proudhonian roots, therefore a certain anti-statist dimension that is crucial in many respects today, also in Europe, includes a vital meaning or notion that we should try and resurrect or reinterpret in a new sense. This has to do with autonomy. This has to do with what you called a moment ago autonomy without autarky, or perhaps self-determination without sovereignty. And it leads to the idea that we are looking for communities of citizens which are intertwined in today's and tomorrow's world of necessity for economic reasons, but which are still in quest, so to speak, unfinished quest of the political forms of that interdependency. And that, of course, raises a problem which would not be easily resolved, which is the problem of equality among these communities of citizens. So I would like to know if this is the direction in which you want to go. And the third point, but you already answered in a sense, was about the meaning of the expression freedom time. But you just explained that in a manner that I find very satisfactory. Freedom time means two things. On the one side, the moment, the historical moment of liberation and emancipation of peoples, and on the other side, it means an interval, an interregnum, perhaps a remainder of time, as Agamben possibly would say, when real alternatives do exist within the liberation movement itself. So you borrowed from, which of course prepare for different futures. So again, it's not a question of rewriting history, but it's perhaps a question of remaking history. And to remake history, and that is to transform the results of the historical process of decolonization, probably presupposes, I will not borrow Benjaminian formulas, but I will invoke the bones of the old bones of Chairman Mao, that what at the time could be considered a secondary contradiction now comes to the fore and becomes in fact a primary contradiction. Sorry for the length, and thank you for your attention.
Of course, there are zillion of things that could be said about Gayatri Spivak. I will just say one, which is very relevant to our meeting. She is the wonderful translator of Césaire's Une Saison au Congo. That would be a wonderful gift. So, Gayatri,
she wrote a fantastic introduction. Okay, now Bachir, are we supposed to be going until 7? Is it just 5 to 4? 6 to 7 then?
No, 8. We go until 8. So
you have time. No, no, it's okay, Suti. It was just, I'm so eager to hear, not because I'm such a good soul, but I really am not an expert in this area. And so I have come to be instructed, frankly, truly. And so therefore, it's better for me to hear questions. But I'll do my duty. I wanted to really talk about the future of the world. And that's why I find your book so exciting, that indeed, to an extent, you did, when you said decolonization as deconstruction of domination, were you, like, you were on the side of that statement, right? You were saying that, okay, I don't believe it. I don't think national liberation is a revolution. I think of Josie Fanon, which then Assia Jabbar quoted and wrote in her book, saying, Dame de la Terre again, ya France, except Algerian against Algerian. And these two guys actually knew that kind of a problem, right? What Foucault talked about as no practice of freedom with negotiated independence. Who knows it better than us? I am born a Hindu, don't believe nothing. We have just lynched a Muslim in the area, like a few 100 yards from my sister's house in the capital city for eating beef. So can I say anything about the wonderful traditions being brought back through tradition, you know, invoking what there was before? I'll tell you what our view is, which was before this absurd and horrifying situation which almost shuts me up. But what has to be remembered is that on the ground stuff, which is old, long durée, those things are also being destroyed by the so-called deconstruction of domination. Because while the guy was being beaten to death before being sewn up, he actually hit the speed dial on a Hindu friend saying they're killing him. That still exists, but it is being destroyed. So that to an extent, I think what we have to think about is that colonialism is often, and this you see, I go to Asia 8 or 9 times a year, and this is why I like your book, because you really, when you say that we have not yet, we do not yet know how to judge them, you know, that is such a fine, statement there. Whether Césaire's and Senghor's untimely acts were, quote, failures, is debatable. The criteria for evaluation are hardly self-evident, like they did a bad job. It's Ho Chi Minh's answer. It's too soon to tell. So therefore, to an extent, although Kissinger gives it to John Lyle, I was told by French medical students that it was Ho Chi Minh. I like that citation. Anyway, so it's too soon to tell. So in that situation, it seems to me what we have to think about is that we have now, because that colonialism in many senses has become a kind of scapegoat. I'm coming back from Berlin, where I was told not to read poetry, but to be political, okay? And what you see now is European nationalism on the left, you know, from friends who knew Condendit, etc., my old friends in Germany, they're becoming nationalists. It's an unbelievable thing. And as I say, I go to Asia 8 or 9 times a year, and I'm very involved. I have a practical involvement with exactly the questions that are being brought up, which Foucault described as not having the practice of freedom and negotiated independence, which I just cited. In this kind of situation, what you're looking at is that just the play of capital and colony as the beginning of our disaster, that nice story is, in fact, we have to claim complicity. Those of us who can, like Bachir Chakravorty, or also another man whom I admire a great deal, James Baldwin. I believe what one has to do as a black American is to take white history, or history as written by whites, and claim it all, including Shakespeare. And Du Bois wrote also that he mentions not, right, Shakespeare. But my real question is, who can claim the Enlightenment? Huh? Who can claim the Enlightenment? And as I was saying, at a celebration of in our countries, you know, when you say that the idea that the people really felt that emancipation would bring a certain absence of domination, etc., I think the word people is essentialized there. Now, I cannot take Martinique and Senegal as examples, because each of these places is different. They wanted to be the same, which is a wonderful thing. But what would have happened is your French, if this plan had worked, your French federation would have been the redoing of the old imperial place, which is happening now with very class-fixed migration, 7 to 9 million people internally displaced in that theater is not being considered, but the, I don't blame them, the somewhat better educated, speaking English well, migrants who are coming are leading to this kind of fault line within what is Europe really, and European values is a phrase that you folks remember, Etienne, when the constitution was coming up, you and I had discussions about why it shouldn't, and it didn't, thank God, it wasn't passed. But that's where all those European values were written about, right in the first 5 pages, as if they have already happened. And now, that stuff is coming up again. So it would have been France, just as we had, the adjective had been dropped, British Commonwealth. The Commonwealth exists. My sister's the person who knew whose house the Muslim was lynched, and she was phoning and she was saying, you will not believe it, they use digital stuff from the damn temple to say this was happening. Can you imagine? So therefore, her husband is sent to the Gambia, to Swaziland, and so on, to help them remake the constitution. It's the Commonwealth. See, it's like this, British has been dropped. But so, to an extent, I mean, people are still talking about Bandung. Now, why did Bandung fail? Bandung fails, if anyone really looks at it politically rather than just how intellectuals emoted over it. It failed on nationalist grounds. And as I said, go to Asia, both to India and to China, and we are, and that scene, I really enjoyed reading your thing on Lenin and Gandhi, again, but I don't think you are on the same page with me in that philosophy. Because
you know so much better.
No, sweetie, Gandhi is kind of a thing that you can neither swallow nor throw out. It's a very different kind of thing. Anyway, whatever. So to go back to what I'm saying, Amod's expression is tremendously ironic because I think he knows what I'm talking about but can't stand up and give me some kind of refutation. Okay, 2 more minutes. So now the thing is that in that situation, our so-called nation-state formations, India and China, there was an imposition of a so-called European state formation, railways, constitution, so on. You should hear Shashi Tharoor's viral speech at the Oxford Union about that. It's really funny. But at any rate, when we are now talking, we are intensely competitive nationally. And so when you look at the world, the Human Development Index, it's nation by nation. So to an extent, the claim to post-nationality is a little strange, whereas these guys were talking about federation and all of that stuff, because they knew that, in fact, I was asked to talk about India and how wonderful it is at the Kennedy Center in Washington in 2013 or so. And we have a pair also, like Senghor and Césaire. We have Gandhi and Tagore, right? And so I was asked to speak about their exchanges, etc. And finally, I was as respectful, I mean, it's hard to imagine me being respectful, but I was. And I was as respectful as I could be, but I said, in their time, they showed that, quote, Orientalism can be manipulated by national liberators themselves to build the new nation in the place of the old colony. It's not a real place. If Gandhi's India or Nehru's India, it's not a real place. And to an extent, what I was saying about Acharya was that, you know, just recently, Acharya was a wonderful man, at a celebration of Acharya's work, I was finally obliged to say, I work in Nigeria, there are millions of people in Nigeria beyond a certain class line who don't know his name. So to an extent, when we say, claiming the Enlightenment, or Dipesh saying, you know, we must keep, you know, it is to an extent, it's trivially true, but it's not something that one can use. Now, what I would like to say in terms of saving the world is that nationalism is not something that can go away. I've written about this, so I mean, it isn't going to go away right now. Because the way in which, and I can only speak about present, the way in which it has been built is using the pre-human private sense of my place and working it into the most public social contract thing. And I've written a whole book on it, so this I'm not going to talk about. Number one is that. So that's why Marx, looking at nationalism, what the hell is it, and the Buddhist said, kind of laid it aside, you know, and so, and then went on to talk about, and then finally, right at the end of his life, talking about Russia, that was another thing altogether. But there was an unsolved thing there, first of all, second of all. And thirdly, my question would be also a little bit of the very oblique relationship of gender to this entire imagining of nationalism, national liberation as a revolution. Okay, see the oblique relationship of gender to the so-called legacy of imperialism. And I have in the, what's it called? It's called Romantic Review, right? That's the journal. I've written an absurd and ignorant thing on the MOBA based on this thing. And I say right at the end, following on that idea of the entire AIDS thing coming from the recorded use of infected syringes on these women who were obliged to take, so they were being done good to by the colony. And so they were obliged, even when they were not, it was not needed, to take these injections, etc. And this book was rather quickly suppressed. So I wrote at the end saying that these women, in Césaire's play, there are these wonderful free women, quote unquote, who have come, of course, if they're a nice male mounting type, jests about the fact that they are using their sexual watch. Because fine, I'm a big girl. But then when one looks at that record, I did say in that piece that these women cannot be grieved, borrowing from Judith Butler, they cannot be grieved. So to an extent, the oblique relationship of gender at the top, the unsingable relationship of gender at the bottom, and the fact that today we have to claim that all of it did not begin with the recent play, 300 years maybe, of the play between capital and colony, that today, with the way in which finance capital works, for example. I'm sorry, I have to now make my sentences very short, so it's a little stupid, but even more stupid than usual, let me say. But today, we have to think about the fact that the old structures, I'm repeating myself, the old structures of hierarchization, not full-fledged exploitation, etc., are coming back. In fact, Bachir and I are engaged in a project looking at this, are coming back in the long durée especially at the very bottom, the colonial things. And these guys suspected something like that. I would ask everyone to read the long letter that Gandhi wrote, published letter, to Andrews before he declared an Indian tradition of nonviolence. And you will see that how these people were not fools, as you say again and again. I think this is a wonderful book. There is much more to be said about it, especially about its implications for what you call the future of the world. I think I'll stop here. I have, in fact, spoken for 15. So that's not so bad.
Gary, you respond, and then
I'll
give a
response
to this wonderful
audience. Well, thank you both. I have been in dialogue with your work textually and in person for so many years. It's really to talk about these issues. The book would have been written. I couldn't have done this work. Apart from the interventions at all. I have dreams like this where I'm sitting here. They don't end well, you know. I come here and I'm barefoot or blind or I can't speak. Yeah, naked. You know, that's the least of it. So there's no way I can do justice to either of these. And like you, I also want to hear from people. But let me try to pick up on just a couple of threads here, both for clarity in terms of what I'm trying to do, but I think for propelling this kind of discussion about, that's really about revisiting revisiting the question and challenge of decolonization. So, one in terms of culture and tradition, to ask who claimed the Enlightenment, and there are these traditions that are deeply problematic. I mean, I certainly, and I know you're not saying this, but I would not want to be understood in any way as saying, look, the Europeans weren't so bad, or the European tradition has a lot going for. I mean, part of what I learned from these guys who are not stupid is that, I mean, and it's ironic because we know them as the kind of most simple-minded culturalist thinkers ever, right? That's what, when I started this project, it's like, why would you work on these? They're like, they're cultural essentialists and bad humanists. They're like, you lose either way. Like, they're idiots and you're kind of an idiot for doing this. But part of what I learned from them over the years is the limits of the cultural critique, right? So the point is not that, these Indian traditions are as problematic as there's more going for Europe. It's that that conversation will never allow us to deconstruct power itself and domination itself. It will only lead to these kind of reversals. And so it's a very simple point, but one point that I think we can...
Can I speak more directly to the microphone? Because people can't hear in the back otherwise.
Oh, okay. It sounds like I'm yelling there. Yelling in the court. Etienne's here.
Doing your hands. I'd be very surprised if people were going to hear you.
I just not speaking at the microphone.
Look only at Susan.
So, I mean, one thing we can learn... There we go. Is that better?
Okay.
One thing we can learn from them is that, very simple, there are progressive and reactionary aspects to all traditions. Another thing we can learn from them is that in an entangled world, it is very difficult to draw a very clear line between where one tradition begins and one tradition ends. And in some ways, Etienne, you asked about, whether we're stuck in this kind of European form. And it just seems to me like this preoccupation with the origins of institutions is so unhelpful at this particular moment. I'm interested in what a concept or an institution or a practice or a tradition gives us or gets us, what it can do, what it can open, what it doesn't open. And this conversation about origins so often seems to be a conversation stopper. Aha, you've said the word nation. Nation is Europe. Therefore, well, what? It's not that nation is good or Europe is good. It's that kind of thinking. So often we've been in conversations, or I feel like I'm in conversations where the task of critical thinking is to take an anti-colonial text or event or figure and hunt for the trace of the universal or the human and to find it, and therefore feel like the work is done. Aha, liberal, Europe, alienated, and there's so many assumptions about authenticity built in there that are, and territory, and consciousness, and history, and the kind of monolithic character of traditions that are deeply problematic. So one of the things they do is remind us that all of these traditions are multidimensional. And there are different aspects of them that could be, they did immanent critique. I believe they did immanent critique. Let me say that just obliquely comes into some of what you're saying. But the gender question is important, if only because I do not address it in
the
book.
For other reasons too.
Yeah. But there are other reasons, yes, of course. But that's the reason why I don't want to blow it off. That's not the reason why it's important. I think, I'll just say this. I've been thinking about, I mean, there's certainly a paternalism there. They both, Césaire, as we know, his own thinking was deep. The incubation of his thinking was with these extraordinary Martinican women, the Nordal sisters, his wife, Suzanne. So women were central to the whole project of this kind of radical humanist orientation to Caribbean modernism. both of them had all kinds of positive things to say about gender equality and the treatment of women, but they were paternalist projects. And the paternalist projects were, they were paternalist in the sense like, we will sort this out and then we will be benevolent to you women. Hold on, wait, and that will come. It's not something that's addressed very often. It's not in the text, which is part of why I didn't address it so much, but I'll just offer one thought, and the one thought is I think there may be a connection between that paternalism and the kind of mystifying lifelong commitment to electoral politics. So as thinkers, I think these are deep, reflective figures who offer us all kinds of incredibly rich resources for thinking about the problem of self-determination. And yet in their own practices, they led political parties. They spent their lives doing electoral politics. They had a kind of belief in the magic of societal transformations by figuring out a different kind of arrangement. And I wonder whether there isn't a link between the paternalism and the parliamentarism. That's just a thought that I have not developed. Let me, since we're saying something about them being radical or not radical, let me connect two things you said, and I'll try to stop in a minute. There's so much that you both put on the table, but I like your pointing to this idea about criteria for evaluation, and it's too soon to tell. And in some ways, part of what I'm interested in doing through the whole book, but also methodologically when we look to these historical figures at these tricky moments, is that rather than do what comes easy, which is to deploy our inherited metrics about who's a good guy and who's a bad guy, what's reformist and what's revolutionary, what's moderate and what's radical, to judge past figures in ways that may make us feel good about being on the right side of history, rather than do that, I'm interested in the way in which these strange figures, and I'm sure Tagore, I know that Tagore and Gandhi also have unsettled friends of mine, scholars as well, I'm interested in the way in which their works, their interventions, the problems they put on the table, and the way they grappled with them force us to unthink what we think we know about what is radical, which is different from revisionism. I'm not saying like they were the real radicals and we're wrong. I'm saying like let's allow them to challenge what we think we know about politics, thinking from their perspective. And that's so that's one point I'd like to make. And let me come back, come around to some of what Etienne said about Fanon, for example. So again, to be clear, for the record, just as this is not an argument against nationalism, but an argument against methodological nationalism, and just as this is not an argument against nationalism, but an argument that that state sovereignty is necessary for self-determination, right? That's not the argument. My argument is, let's start at the beginning. Let's start with what Marx calls human emancipation and say, that's what we want. What the hell does it look like? You know, given the world we live in, how would we get there? What, both given our ideals and given our constraints. And so that's what, how I'm interested in thinking with these people. So that brings up Fanon. This is also not a critique of Fanon at all, and I have zero interest in pitting Césaire against Fanon. It is a critique of the Fanonian reading of Negritude, of Senghor, and of this kind of project. And there is a strange way in which the Fanonian reading of Senghor has stood in for 60 years for Senghor himself, and has allowed people not to go to the text, not to go to the... So part of my project is not to say these guys were right, but to say that in this historical conjuncture, there's a kind of political specificity, an intelligent, a political, historical, specificity and intelligibility to what they were doing and why they were doing. So one of the things I learned is how Fanon, Senghor, and Césaire, different as they are, and they're quite different in all kinds of ways, and the disputes are substantive and real, and yet they were all in different ways seeing a similar problem on the horizon, right? This neocolonial problem on the horizon. And part of what I'm insisting is like, look, these were different ways of trying to come to terms with the problem of freedom in the post-war world. It's not that one was a hero and the others were idiots, right? So I'm not interested in throwing Fanon out either. I'm interested in understanding all of them in this historical moment and constellation. So again, part of the problem, part of what I'm suggesting here about why we need to pay attention to their projects was not just because, not that nationalism would fail necessarily, or that non-Western elites would be complicit with terrible post-colonial violence, which may or may not be true, but the really important point for me is their insight that in this world, given global capitalism, given imperial geopolitics, given a long imperial history of mobility and mixture and interdependence, in that world, delinking is not possible. We can agree or disagree, they may have been wrong, but that's the starting point from which we need to understand these strange propositions and plans they came up with. And that's, as you're saying, they saw that. They said, delinking is not possible. Formal political independence will not undo all the dense web of interdependencies that, of course, will continue to exist in the post-war period. They recognized that a relation would always exist. So the question was, what should be the terms of that relationship? And they came up with one set of solutions that we can have all kinds of arguments about, but it's, so that's the work I'm trying to do, is bring us back to that starting point. Again, to think about that moment and our moment. And I guess I'll just end here by saying, you know, certainly their solutions can't be our solutions, but we are once again in a world historical moment where human freedom is an open question, right? Where the framework through which self-management, democratic self-management, which in some ways has to be by determinant, intentional communities, democratic self-management needs to be thought in relation to planetary politics, right? And both of those things are absolutely imperative, and it's not clear how one does that. And that, back to what you were saying, Etienne, I think some of the writing you have done over the years about, for example, citizenship without community, right? Those kinds of seemingly paradoxical formulations that you keep offering us, which are not paradoxical at all. I mean, I think, you know, the way in which you're trying to think what self-management under current global conditions would look like, and that's one of the ways I understand your political theoretical project, has a deep affinity, even if you would disagree with all kinds of specific propositions that these strange characters came up with. There's a deep affinity between those two problems, and that's also why I'm trying to think that past and our present. Yes.
Dear, I
please.
Want
please.
Go ahead.
No, we have. You know, I
apologize for not doing justice.
I just want to raise again one question and to name a name which. Which of course is never very far from here, but hasn't been named yet. So the problem is equality, you know, because one of the reasons why sovereign independences, perhaps one of the main reasons, the crucial reasons, why sovereign independences could not be bracketed and brushed aside as the necessary instrument of liberation and decolonization was certainly the idea, the conviction that without independence and sovereign independence, remaining within some sort of federation in Paris, you would in fact never achieve even a moderate degree of equality among peoples, races, and so on, and genders. So, the result is not equality. It's not equality among nations. And it's not equality within nations for a number of reasons. Therefore, the problem is still there. And if you admit that this is an important value and goal, you have to return to it regularly. And the name I want to mention is Edward Said, for the following reason. One moment, among many, when I was deeply impressed by his talk and his expression in the Palestinian question and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, was a moment when he wrote a famous piece, which I believe even became the title for one collection of his essays. Very strong, very brutal, leaving no choice. Equality or nothing. Equality or nothing. Yeah. And from there, of course, resulted his complex positions, moving positions. And if he were still here, I'm sure he would have to move again, probably be very desperate, but that's... because neither the one-state solution nor the two-state solutions would prove directly or simply adapted to the realization of that goal. And therefore he had to move to a sort of meta-level, in which, and others tried to follow in his footsteps, in which he would say, I'm not saying the two-state solution is the solution, or the one-state solution is the solution, which is a kind of federation in the sense. I'm just saying that the one criterion on which we cannot give up, and which we cannot abandon, is the criterion of equality. That doesn't cancel liberty, of course, but it adds a degree of complexity, which is, in matters of decolonization, I tend to believe impossible to ignore.
It depends on who is claiming equality, and I don't want to talk more,
please.
But I think I want to put this out as a question. For a Palestinian leader to say equality or nothing, these are not pronounced in a vacuum. These are not abstract statements. It's quite different from the fact that everyday realities makes it mean that equality, democracy is a hospitable and autoimmune system, as you know. It is not possible to get around the fact that equality is equality for people who do not resemble me at all. I wish I could talk about the involvement in Algeria, about which I know a great deal, underreported, of women's involvement in the suspension of the constitution after the first time the Sahel gained. I think the question of equality is not something that is just simply not in conflict with the question of liberty. And trying to put this intuition into the children of the so-called largest democracy in the world, who have nothing at all, clandestinely playing with stones and looking after cows at the age of five, that equality is other people, not me, justifying self-interest. This is a very hard task. And to an extent, that inconvenient thing is what these two brothers were waiting for. Because Tagore, after all, Orientalism, put the children of the rich under the trees and called it Indian tradition. That's something that one doesn't talk about because it's not fair, but I'm a Bengali, I can say anything about it.
May I suggest that you have the last word after everybody speaks?
Sure.
All express your desire to learn from
questions.
Yes, please.
Gary, thank you very much for all three panelists. I mean, I really want to push Etienne's point a bit harder. I'm a little bit troubled by the kind of argument which Fred Cooper and you are making about essentially the existence of this federal option, which in some ways was prematurely foreclosed by the rush for national sovereignty. I think that there's some problems with this. There's, first of all, it seems to me that there's some quite serious anachronisms built into this argument. I'll talk about some of the consequences of this. I mean, the 1945-46 moment is very special. This is the moment not just of the departmentalization, but when George Padmore publishes How Russia Transformed Her Colonial Empire. This vision which Césaire has in this period is very much linked to the project of socialist transformation. And it's inseparable from it. And it seems to me that Césaire already is moving in a very different direction from Senghor by the early 50s. You kind of allude to this slightly, but I think you could have put much more weight on that. What is certainly clear is that by 1948, when the Congress of the Peoples of Europe, Asia, and Africa gathers in Futu, there are very clear denunciations of all of these contemporary European imperial proposals for freedom within the French Union, equal partners within the Netherlands Union, or dominion status in the British Commonwealth, which appear to have such a retrospective luster for Cooper and John Darwin. The Pan-Africanist delegate, Peter Abrams, put, he says, colonial people do not want to cooperate as inferiors. And the problem really, which was recognized by colonial nationalists in the late 40s and in the 50s, was that without national sovereignty, there would be a lack of ontological equality, a perpetual dependence and state of tutelage. And there are therefore very good reasons why people like Ruben Niobe, Felix Mumier, Mick Ben Barka, quite apart from Fanon and Sekou Touré, say this is nonsense. And the point is that Césaire himself, by 1956, is quite clearly moving in this direction. And he's doing so because of the fact that it's quite clear that this particular socialist utopia, which he thought might be the partner of decolonization, simply was not going to work out that way because of the particular imperialist characteristics of the French Communist Party. And it's very interesting that later on, the moment when he does soften on independence, as you note in your book, is in 1980, when Mitterrand comes back into power. In that very brief moment of extraordinary optimism at the beginning of Mitterrand's first administration, in which it was presumed that Mitterrand would in fact be implementing a much more radical program than he then did. So I think there's a kind of disconnection with this kind of socialist problem, which was quite central, I think, for Césaire. But my second concern with this is that I think that this kind of argument, which is part of a kind of leftish deprecation of the nation state and of national sovereignty, which has really gone on since the 1980s. You know, it's not something new to this kind of argument from that perspective. It's very much complicit with a certain kind of neoliberal attack on the sovereignties of weak nations. And I'm not just saying this by chance. You find Fred Cooper's language quoted very exactly by Robert Kaplan in his article in The Atlantic in March 2014, in which he talked about possibly empires offered other forms of sovereignty, federations, which might provide a better kind of future. So it seems to me that what we need to be very clear about when we enter this territory is the way in which it is connected with particular contemporary languages, which have to do with essentially the reinvention of imperialism at a later moment.
Thank you very much. So we give a response while...
Yeah. First of all, you have a nice reading of Fred Cooper's book, and you should take it to Fred Cooper. I mean, it's not great. I mean, I don't know if you... So, I mean, that... I mean, that's what I'm hearing. Of course, there is a risk of the moment... I mean, this is tricky, delicate stuff. And the moment you raise questions about the limits or limitations of national sovereignty, you run the risk of playing into a conservative discourse about, as you nicely say, an attack on the sovereignty of weak nations. I don't know how I can be construed as saying that. I am reading and taking seriously what Senghor and Césaire said about this kind of problem at that moment. Of course there were good reasons for nationalists to be nationalists at the time, and part of what I'm trying to do is so I'll say it again, this is not an argument against anti-colonial nationalism, it's an argument against precisely this kind of allergic reaction to anything that isn't anti-colonial nationalism as necessarily reactionary. I think, you know, so you talk about, let me say a couple things. You talk about Césaire's departmentalization vision being linked to a socialist project. and then him shifting in 1956. But in 1956, he shifts precisely to this federalist possibility. So my job and our job is to try to think about what, why might he be doing that? I don't think Césaire is attacking the sovereignty of weak nations. I don't think Césaire is reconstructing, is producing an apology for empire, although for many, many decades we haven't read either of these thinkers precisely because of that fear and that accusation. I think you bring up a very important point, which is that in the post-war moment, different kind of, there was a very robust discourse about federalist politics, both with respect to the end of empire and with respect to decolonized peoples. And it's crucial to remember, and I will say it again, like, I don't think there's anything intrinsically progressive about federalism. There are reactionary forms of federalism. South Africa, apartheid was a federalism. Jim Crow is a federalism. There are reactionary forms of federalism. There are progressive forms of federalism. And one of the really interesting things about this post-war moment is how many debates were conducted in the idiom of these different types of federalist proposals. So absolutely, there are all kinds of imperial federalist proposals. And I think if you pay attention to some of the differences that Césaire or Senghor were insisting on at different moments, there is the kind of, they point in different directions. And back to Etienne's question about equality, I think the crucial, one of the crucial things to realize, and again, this, these were utopian projects and these guys were poets, but part of the aesthetic imagining of a different kind of future is not just saying, look, in the world of Cold War geopolitics, we have to hitch our future to France's wagon, otherwise we're going to be crushed by American imperialism, which was part of what they were saying, but they were also saying, part of the insight of delinking is not possible, is that social relations in the metropole have to be fundamentally transformed also. And this goes back to Said and the one-state solution, right? It was not about, hey, let's just get into this British Commonwealth thing and hope for to negotiate a better deal with France. That's exactly what de Gaulle wanted. That's exactly what these various imperial projects for federation wanted, and maybe what, you know, we can take that up with Fred and his book, and we'll bracket that. But it's crucial for me, when I read both of these guys, and they were different, and you're right, Césaire and Senghor were different. Yes, but we also have to challenge this idea, like, Césaire, radical hero, Senghor, you know, like, really, Senghor is more like Césaire. Césaire is more like Senghor with respect to this project than we want to remember. And maybe Senghor is a deeper thinker than we have been led to believe. I mean, I think I want to question the stakes we have in constantly reproducing this kind of good guy, bad guy binary, and actually think our way into this moment. And if we're going to think our way into this moment, they both believed that decolonization had to operate on an imperial scale. That it's not just that decolonization in one country was impossible, but decolonization that did not fundamentally transform the very basis of political association between former imperial powers and former colonies would never work. I'm not saying that their proposal would have worked, but I'm saying this is what was behind their proposal, which was a vision of radical equality. So I'm not talking about a liberal idea of liberty. I'm talking about Marx's idea of human emancipation, which is, of course, is fundamentally based on a vision of social equality.
Can I say a small word?
Okay,
you know, what I was saying, though, was that this idea, which is a wonderful thing, they were really, to use a phrase of mine, affirmatively sabotaging the production of the colonial subject. They were both colonial subjects, and they were using that in order to do something for now. Fine. But this, these projects were so marked by specific imperialisms that it took, if you want to relate it to socialism, then you really have to, mind you, there are other things one can say, but you really have to think it through. I mean, and I would suggest, since I don't want to talk too much, that one might look at Du Bois's essay called The Negro Mind Looks Out, where he was the old man, a well-known essay, he was the old guy speaking to the younger Han and Renaissance people, where he actually compares imperialisms. That's already global. It's not like a federation within my imperialist tradition. That was the problem. It wasn't that it was socialism or anything. Socialism in one country, we know about it. But socialism of transforming one empire, think about it. You see? That's what I would say.
Thank you. Gary, I haven't read the book, but in your presentation, I understood, I heard you talk, I thought reflectively about struggles and reflection and the intersection between freedom time and enslavement. Can you elaborate more on that? And I think it's leading right into the Du Bois philosophy and how the position that he took in his philosophy with this whole notion of negritude and colonialism. Can you please help me with that? It's Gary. Sure.
Yes.
You're
yes.
The one that I took your notes from that.
Shall we take another questions? And so that Gary has a
long winded answer. I know you're
just
here.
Just before,
I will be sure
before that, I want to just to remind it, there is a point that needs probably to be made also, because when you talk about federalism, I know that the emphasis is on the immediate post World War II. But federalism, in the spirit of someone like Senghor, actually goes beyond simply association with France. I mean, what we have in mind is association with France. You cannot understand Senghor's philosophy of federalism without what he wrote, actually himself, about federalism. And what he continued to write after independence, when independence was decided, because federalism at that point was, for him, directed against France. Actually, what he wanted to keep was the federation of ex-ROF and ROF against France, which wanted to decolonize separately, territory by territory, as they call it. Making Sekou Touré a hero, yes, it was a good thing that at one point someone said no, at that point to De Gaulle's blackmail. But the idea behind Senghor and Mamadou Dia, the fact that Mamadou Dia, who was much more on the left than Sekou Touré, followed Senghor on that point, is France was going to decolonize territory by territory,
of course.
And the evil, maximum evil from Senghor was what he called balkanization. People would be, would not know something, actually he coined the word. Balkanization that he used was coined by someone. He looked at the Balkans and he said, I don't want this for Africa, independently from France. And when it comes to France, he said very clearly in 1947, if that is the only alternative, we are ready to fight for independence. So independence came after his own notion of federalism, and federalism was not just associating Africa with France, it was also keeping all these territories together. So we have to connect it with Senghor's notion of Pan-Africanism if you want to have actually the whole picture of the conversation and why the discussion around federalism was done. So you have that question, and then, oh, Susan, and you will...
Just apropos of that, just today I was in a... I was in an exam in art history, and actually the student Nicholas Drossos is here for a postdoc at Columbia. And it's very interesting because he takes the time 1956 to talk about Eastern European examples along with the Soviet Union. And that part is not interesting for this discussion. What's interesting is Yugoslav federalism, because it was very vibrant, and it could have been a model, I don't know, for these thinkers. It certainly was, or they could have been a model for Yugoslavia. In other words, there's a very, very much the thought in the air in the mid-1950s with the thought, right, that there could be a kind of multi-ethnic federalism. So exactly when you said balkanization, I thought, is that a word that was consciously linking to the alternative solution of Tito? Because of course the interesting thing is, like I said, 1957, the meeting of non-aligned nations in Belgrade, because this came up in the exam, because the actual building in which this meeting took place was an example of this kind of multi-ethnic, quasi-socialist alternative. I just think it's interesting because we're often so kind of locked into the East-West story that we forget these other stories that happen in between. So that's just something to throw out.
Remember, Praxis International was deeply identified with existentialism.
That's it.
Yes. So the connection is just a little bit
exactly.
After.
So
the connections.
But the connections are already there, and it's a moment of thinking of third world alternatives. But of course, then we have to look at what happened to Yugoslavia.
And
we can't ignore that.
It's very interesting that you brought in the years of 1956 and you're taking it outside of this country. Now, I came into this conference this evening because I saw on the website the title is what brought me here. And I'm very much interested in the Negritude and the colonization and what took place in this country. And Gary, you alluded a little at the beginning in terms of the struggles between the struggles in reflection and the intersection between freedom time and enslavement. Did I not hear you say that? I took those notes. So, I mean, it's a world, it's a global issue, but I don't want to take it away from the inconsistencies that is prominent in this country. I need to hear what's going on in here with the Negritude and the decolonization and those years, using a timeline which is global. We need to situate it, being that we're in New York City in the continental United States of America. Let's not take it way over there. Talk to me about what's going on in this country.
Let me say two quick things about
Gary, speaking in the mic.
I don't think I said enslavement in my opening comments, but I think it's a terrific question and a very important issue. And one of the distinctive, and you can, here I am taking it back to what I know, so forgive me, but maybe we'll bring it back around. But one of the things I learned from Césaire, and what Césaire was very sensitive to, was the kind of long, I talked about the long view.
Yes.
And part of the long view has to do with the history precisely of enslavement and Atlantic slavery in the Caribbean. And Aimé Césaire kind of, we know this, many of you know his poetry well, his essays, he's not only constantly making references to that long-term past of slavery and insisting that the challenges of emancipation from slavery in a certain way continue to be before us, he keeps saying. It's here now, we haven't done that work. But part of the lesson he learned from that is that the Caribbean history is a history of all kinds of forms of emancipation that automatically institute new forms of domination. And his kind of insistence that there's a non-self-evident relationship between a certain political arrangement and freedom comes from this kind of deep historical consciousness of a long history of progress and regress, of openings and reversals, of openings and foreclosures. And it seems to me that his stopping and saying, let's figure out what would equality mean. Let's not rush to apply a certain recipe. Let's actually think about how we would make a certain kind of socialist, post-imperial, democratic, multiracial world had to do with the kind of long, the long historical consciousness and sensitivity to the problem of freedom in the 300 years of Caribbean history. Thinking about the United States, I mean, we both know, thinking about the United States, that certainly citizenship and formal equality is no guarantee against, you know, exterminationist racism, right? Constant endemic racism. So the problems, as you said, the problem of equality, of course, I mean, these are all problems. There's no framework Senghor falling across the epoch. No. I mean, there's no, you know, all this stuff has to be worked out in practice. There is no kind of framework or arrangement. No constitutional framework will suddenly, like, bring equality into being, right? All we can do, all, you know, they thought, is that we can create frameworks through which best to pursue these kinds of ways forward. And there were a number of ways to do that, but, sorry, I got thrown by the call. Let me just say something about the United States, and it's a useful, you know, and you mentioned Du Bois. I mean,
And the intersection.
Well, you know, when we think about the long-term struggle for racial justice in the United States, we don't automatically start with what fools African Americans were for trying to democratize this place that they own, that is a homeland, that is as much a black nation as any other kind of nation, right? But we do start there immediately in other kind of contexts. And that's a kind of very interesting and useful point of comparison for me. There are huge differences between Du Bois, for example, and Aimé Césaire, and C.L.R. James, and Léopold Senghor. But all of them, in a certain way, were part of a new world Black Atlantic project of democratizing this world. They all had this insight that there's no getting on a boat or a plane and going somewhere where these problems don't continue to be problems. And I don't love all of their solutions by far, but I take that as one way to productively think the African-American experience and the kind of French, African-Antillean experiences, though they're, you know, they're very, very different. Does that help a little bit?
A little.
Susan, absolutely. I mean, Senghor is a problematic guy, and also these guys were they were engaged in practical politics as well as philosophical and aesthetic reflection. So their writings are always methodologically tricky because you want to take the text seriously and think they mean what they say, and yet they're also doing certain kinds of work in certain kinds of places. That meant that Senghor's Federalist ideas were not always consistent. And sometimes he invoked, you know, Germany, the United States, and Canada in deeply problematic ways. Other times he talked specifically about Yugoslavia. He talked about Lenin's first Federalist vision for the Soviet Union, and wonderful quotes there. Césaire talks often about the Italian constitution and regional autonomy. So they were definitely mindful of these other examples, and that's part of this kind of non-civilizational thinking, that, like, where are these actually existing historical examples where subaltern peoples, whether within or outside of Europe, have attempted to figure out a way to manage self-management, what you were talking about, because the vision was always Proudhonian in the sense of federations of federations of federations, scaling all the, you know, from the most local community up to the planet, which is, you know, it's not necessarily logical, but that was the hope. So these other Federalist experiments, which were, I mean, one of the strange things, challenges for us thinking historically about this moment, as Richard asked us to do, is that on the one hand, Federalism was everywhere. I don't want to suggest that these two guys were the untimely Federalists. That Federalist thinking was everywhere, on the right and the left, in the metropole and, you know, and colonies. And at the same time, it's not just that we forgot that. There were real historical forces that, as Bachir is saying, it wasn't only the, you know, trade unionists who wanted certain African nationalism. Former imperial powers also wanted national solutions at a certain moment. The UN wanted a kind of interstate order based on national states. So what's interesting about this moment is that federalism was everywhere, and yet so quickly it almost seemed like, how could one think of such a ridiculous alternative?
You know, you have to think about the fact also that there's a deep, and no one's going to like this remark, that there is a deep, unacknowledged sense of how can we acknowledge that these people are not going to be able to manage on their own. This is, Lenin called these people the progressive bourgeoisie, not for nothing. And you know, this completely unacknowledged thing of, you know, Edward Said, whom I adored and whom I've known, whom I knew since 1974, in the second edition of Orientalism, toward the end, calls Gandhi and Nehru subalterns. No, sir. These were upper class people. And there was this complete sense that could not be acknowledged. My people, my country, the discovery of India, non-violence, ahimsa, and etc., suppressing the popular movements. There was an inability to acknowledge the practical sense that these people, my people, are not going to be able to manage on their own. And this is something that, you know, this thing, this aporia, haunts these two good men. And I was really not thinking, Bashir, of France being tamed, but former French colonies. Those were the separations, you know what I mean? And that carries through a certain kind of tradition of imperialism, which is, I mean, the thing to really look at is Maspero and Aimé Césaire and all of these people writing about Fanon, Présence Africaine 1962, which you no doubt have read, which I found in Du Bois's library. I was trying to think about the old guy about to die, reading this stuff, and in his collection also something from Padmore, who had written the thing about communism or pan-Africanism, giving to Du Bois with an absolutely heart-rending handwritten dedication, a 16th century document. It doesn't exist anywhere else in the world, and the collection is going to hell. So at any rate, giving this 16th century document in his library, with mouse droppings and the pages falling apart. So one has to look at this in terms of this sense, why in 1948 Du Bois took back the talented tenth. Because he was smart enough, strong enough to acknowledge that even in my community, I mean, he would have called this whole leadership complex, as he did again and again, you know, in your red life, you know, petty bourgeois ideology. He used that old phrase, even about.
You touch me when you said that.
But we are complicit here. So, you know, we call it that Lincoln, petty bourgeois ideology. Very honest man. So I can really say that that's what I was thinking about. Not about France, but about former French possessions. That's the thing. There's a conversation somewhere which you have listened to, where Badmore, Sierra James, and Du Bois are discussing the much younger person, Fanon, and why it's easier to be a radical in the West Indies. It's fascinating stuff. There's nothing to miss out for. This is the kind, these are the connections.
Question here, and then you, and then you. I mean, first I just wanted to thank all of you. This book is fabulous. Four people on stage are really, for me, the condition of possibility. I just completed a study on self-determination in the Haitian Revolution. And as I said, I mean, this book is so fantastic, and all four of you. I guess I have like a kind of synthesis comment just to put out there. It has to do with limited existence and scale. And I think it speaks to the topic of the book and these very thoughtful responses. The first thing that I did when I was thinking about, with Césaire, Fanon, James, Haitian Revolution, I mean, it's a sort of typical move. I looked at Raymond Williams' keywords, right? And his etymology, determined, he talks about how determined sets up a limit, but it's also a contingent, unknown, and surpassable limit. So it's almost like a sort of line of flight prior to that word being sort of solved. And that's the one thing I just wanted to kind of put out there. The second thing is, I really love this remark that Professor Balibar made, referring to Said's equality or nothing. And I was thinking about when saying that with Shakespeare, and when you said it, it's I heard the voice. I mean, specifically, and I heard Professor Wilder in terms of new categories. Du Bois in Black Reconstruction, to paraphrase, writes famously, either America will admit black people on the basis of equality, or America will cease to exist. And people get hung up on this question of admittance, like why would you want to be admitted to that? But not in the way that both equality or nothing vis-a-vis the Palestinians and Israel by Said, and America will cease to exist, really calls for like a complete negation and reconstruction of categories, not joining an always already flawed project. And the last thing I want to say, and why it's just so touching to hear all four of you, you know, pay such homage to these thinkers. In the context of political organization, I transcribed Amiri Baraka's kind of notes or position paper, really just a travelogue, when right prior to Césaire passed away, he went to visit him for some time. And what was striking, and you know, they had very, very different ideas about self-determination, but what was striking when you read the sort of Baraka's reflections is that it's a question of scale. The always already like international political interlocutors for Césaire at that moment of his life are just the people in his neighborhood, in his town, on his street. And I said always already international. So there's some way in which just like his day-to-day sort of material practice, who he's making connections with, embodies that sort of particular universal, but also like local and international problematic that I think all four of you just really sort of hold the torch for in such elegant, beautiful ways. I'm grateful.
Thank you. So I wanted to ask, what do you think that the independence movements does? What do you think that the independence movements of Scotland away from the UK, Catalonia away from Spain, and even Greece away from the European banks, what can or have they learned from the liberation movements of Africa? Because it seems to me that these movements are away from the same colonizers that colonized Africa. And also that these movements are not just about nationalism, but linked to anti-neoliberal sentiments. Maybe.
Three points. Can you give an example as to what country has embraced federalism successfully? That's the first point. The second point, Mr. Barry Williams, Wiley, you said, you referenced George Padmore and C.L.R. James, but you never linked them to let on Dr. Eric Williams. And the first one was, in your intro, especially, you said that Negritude is back. When did it go? And when did it come back?
I don't think I mentioned Padmore. I think Eric Williams' insight about capitalism and slavery is absolutely crucial in the sense that, you know, I didn't talk about this here, but part of, again, deeply problematic, you know, flawed, contradictory problem, in question-begging propositions, and yet that Eric Williams' insight about the wealth of the West is absolutely at the center, and this is another link back to enslavement that I should have mentioned before. Part of this refusal to encounter modern politics as a foreigner is not only about a non-identitarian relation to tradition, but it's an insight that in the concrete history of Western capitalism, African and Antillean labor and resources have been crucial in producing the wealth and prosperity and power of Europe, so that, in the book I keep writing, like, part of their point was, we cannot agree to a situation where the day after independence, we will approach the French state as foreigners begging for aid. This is our wealth, and we own this stuff, right? So there's a way in which they are, even though, according to all kinds of other metrics, you know, Senghor is not a revolutionary the way Padmore is. Of course he isn't, and James is not, and yet I want to kind of think us back to a moment where there may be more affinities than we we realize. Federalism successfully, I mean, we're back to the, you know, like, what time frame, what scale do we use to think about that? I mean, we can link that to this other question. It seems to me that I can't think of good examples where this kind of, I don't know, radical socialist and democratic idea of federalism has been produced, but there are these nodes, right? Marx, in writing about the Paris Commune, had this vision that this commune is the kernel of a whole, right? It was supremely local, the beautiful and ephemeral moment of self-management, but he's like, this has to be the kind of the vehicle, not just the model, but the vehicle through which this kind of thing happens on larger and larger scales. And I think, you know, the radical, you know, I don't know enough about Scotland, but it is very interesting that we have, so again, my point is that there aren't recipes for these kinds of things. Just like in the Algerian case, this kind of federalist solution would have only led to a post-colonial apartheid. It would have allowed the settler community to rule a white supremacist state. It would not have made any sense at all. So we have to do that Gramscian thing of going into each situation and saying, like, you know, what is the relation of forces here, and in what set of arrangements would be the most progressive? So Scotland is such an interesting example. Greece is another interesting example, because so often in the kind of, you know, it's terrible, you know, the egregious treatment by the European Union of Greece is terrible, and everyone is saying this shows, you know, this reveals the bankruptcy of the European Union. Absolutely, 100%, it reveals precisely that. But so often that slips into this reveals the bankruptcy of any kind of federal hope. And actually, to me, it reveals the idea that the European Union was never organized as that kind of truly democratic federation based on any kind of equality. It was a, you know, it was organized by finance ministers, and it was a confederation, an economic confederation.
So there was no country that embraced the principle of federalism successfully. Because I recall Eric Williams championed the federal issue in the Caribbean and didn't work.
Yes, correct. There were all kinds of, and I wonder, I mean, we can have an interesting, because one of the interesting things is, like, there was this kind of post-colonial transcontinental idea, and then there are other kinds of regional experiments in federalism. The West Indies Federation, the Mali Federation, I believe Syria, Egypt and Syria were federated at a certain moment, but that again reproduces this problem of elite, you know, like federation in a limited way. Now, we don't live in a world where this is the dilemma, right? The only way this works is if is if metropoles are also reconfigured. And these guys were poetic enough, utopian enough, or crazy enough to, like, ask France to negate itself. That would never happen apart from a mass social movement, an armed struggle. I don't know, but it's interesting to think about an armed struggle for reconciliation and cooperation and not for separation. I mean, these are paradoxes, but these are the paradoxes that, that's the challenge. It seems to me that the challenge for thinking about emancipation at this moment.
But capital can do it. We are not once mentioning the North and the South.
Right.
Not once. It's still as if it's all, we are the ones who own our property in that decolonizing moment, so how can France take it, so are we going to be foreigners? But today, the North and the South is such a phenomenon, and the separation between the rich and the poor are increasing in such a degree inside what used to be the old post-colonial spaces, that's where I began. That we have to think that the conjunction has changed. Capital can make connections that these good guys could not make. You know what I mean?
Yeah. The issue about negritude, did you answer that
please? Oh, yeah. What I meant was just something that Gary also mentioned, the fact that for a long time negritude was considered understood and closed case. This was the counter-essentialist answer to colonial essentialism. And what a book like Gary's is show is that it is much more complicated than that, and we should reopen the books and read these people. It was not done in the past. Years, I would say. Post-colonial literature was just very dismissive of Negritude in general. In general, also, people would just say, okay, well, let's save at least Césaire, but the African guy, really, essentially. So, okay, we could go on until tomorrow morning. This is very interesting to